board is what I usually go by.
Okay. And by your legal name?
That's all of my signature is H4.
And it's Gravett, not Gravett.
Oh, I'm sorry, Gravett. I apologize. Are you good? Great. This is the deposition of H4 Gravett, taken pursuant to notice and agreement of counsel for all purposes permitted by law. All objections except as the form of the question and responsiveness of the answer are reserved. The deponent will read and sign deposition, correct?
Yes.
And all agreements regarding the videotaping of the deposition from the first deposition in this case will be, or second deposition in this case, will be incorporated herein.
That would be the Chief Tatum and Chief Cook, or Assistant Chief Cook,
yes.
Depositions. We agree to all the stipulations.
Agree.
And if you could swear to this.
Sir, raise your right hand, please. Do you swear or affirm the testimony you're about to give in this case to be the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth?
I do.
Good morning, Mayor Gravett.
Good morning.
If you could state your name for the court report.
H. Ford Gravett.
Okay. And is that your legal name?
That's my legal name.
Okay. If you could, we're going to start with just family members, just chart them out for us. I need the names of your mother and father.
This would be the subject of redaction.
Oh, I'm sorry, subject of redaction, yeah.
Okay.
Maybe I'll do that every time.
All right, it's a good way.
Who is James Otwell?
James Otwell, senior, junior, the third, which one?
The James Otwell that you described as your mentor who was a state representative.
It was James Otwell, Jr. He was the owner of Andean Motor Company when I was growing up, and I worked for him.
Okay.
So we can be clear, are we done with the questions that you think will elicit testimony that needs to be redacted?
For the time being. I mean,
okay.
I think we'll hit a couple other areas. But yeah, for the time being. And you worked for Mr. Otwell?
I did.
Okay. And what did you do for him?
As I indicated, he was the owner of Andean Motor Company, which is a General Motors dealership. And I started out working for him when I was still in school.
This is high school?
No, I was still in middle school, back, I guess you'd call it middle school.
Okay.
I was real young in 1955, and I worked for him as a helper in the cleanup of automobiles and the body shop.
And how long did you work with him?
Worked with him till 1979, which would have been 24 years.
And did you then go into the auto repair business yourself?
Well, I was in it altogether, yes. Went into it myself, and I was in it altogether 44 years.
And what was the name of the business that you began?
Ford's Body and Auto Service.
How would you describe your relationship with Mr. Otwell?
Objection. Subject to that objection, you can answer if you understand the question.
He was a father figure to me.
And was he an inspiration in your decision to enter public life?
He was.
Okay, and if you could...
One of them.
If you could give me just a little snapshot of how he inspired you.
Well, he's but not having any background, he indicated that I had leadership qualities, and he thought I would be a good public servant, so he encouraged me to run for city council.
And And was that your first public position as a member of City Council for the City of Cumming?
It was.
Okay. And how long did you serve as a member of the City Council prior to running for mayor?
2 terms.
Okay. And do you remember your district number?
Wasn't one.
Okay. Were they at large then?
It was.
Okay. And then you made the decision to run for mayor after 2 terms as on City Council, correct?
That's true.
Okay.
Along with Mr. Outwell's blessing.
Okay. And was Miss, I mean, figure out how to phrase this, was did you have a, was it a contested race for mayor initially?
It was.
Okay. And was Mr. Otwell's endorsement given to you?
It was.
Public endorsement?
Well, I think it would be unquestionable that it was public endorsement since I was working for him, and due to the fact that he was a mentor of mine, and whether it came out in a newspaper that it was a public endorsement, I'm not sure.
Okay. And you prevailed in that election?
I did.
Do you remember, was it close?
I don't remember.
And who was your opponent?
Lawrence Gordon.
Okay. And what year was that?
1970.
Okay. And how many times have you run for re-election since that time?
I think it's probably about maybe 10 or 12.
Okay. And have you had contested races for mayor since then?
I have.
Okay. About how many times?
I would think probably 3, maybe 2, but I'm thinking 3. It could be 2.
Okay. And do you remember when the last one of those contested elections was?
It's been over 20 years, so
okay.
Let me back up on that. The last election was contested, I think. It's been 7 years, so
okay.
It's been contested, and I can remember that because my opponent was Bill Daniel.
How long are the terms of mayor?
Well, it's varied over the years. So originally it was 2 years, and it changed to 5 years. Then to get balanced out with the state of Georgia on election, with election laws, it changed to have staggered terms. And the last election, my term was 2 years.
Oh, so you're staggering the terms now to have a scenario where you're going to be in conjunction with Georgia state elections and not have to have separate elections. Is that correct?
I believe that's correct.
Okay. Have you been married more than once?
No, sir.
Okay. Do you have any illegitimate children?
I don't.
Any children out of wedlock?
I don't.
Okay. Who is Angie Mullinex?
She's a friend.
What kind of a friend? Is this a friendship of a sexual nature or?
She's a traveling friend.
Okay. Kind of going back to my question, is this a relationship of a sexual nature or not?
Let me object. How is this reasonably calculated to lead to the discovery of admissible evidence in this case?
We're basically trying to figure out whether, when we get to jury selection, what role Angie Mullinex, not person's knowledge of Angie Mullinex is going to be. That's all. I'm not going to go any farther into it. I just need to know that.
Well, if the mayor has a personal relationship with Ms. Mullinex, how in the world is that relevant in this case, whether they, what their sexual relationship is? If you want to ask him if he has a personal relationship with her, I think that's fine.
It's just going to extend my questions about her, but that's fine. I mean, I can do it. How many times have you traveled with Angie Mullinex outside of the City of Cumming?
It'd be more than one.
Okay. Would it be more than five?
I'd say outside of Cumming, you limit your scope of traveling outside of Cumming. Cumming is, geographically, is a very small area.
Sure, then let's do outside of Forsyth County. That's a fair question.
Outside of Forsyth County, I did last night, we went to dinner together, which was outside Forsyth County.
Okay. How often do you have dinner together in an average week?
When I have dinner outside of my home, it may be a couple of times.
Okay. Have you ever traveled out of state with her?
I have.
Okay. And where have you gone?
There was trips that are trip to Florida.
Okay. Was that for vacation or business last vacation? What was it for?
It was I guess sightseeing.
Okay. Any other occasions you traveled out of state with Angie Molinets?
I'm sure it has been. Right off, I don't recall at all, but I'm sure it has been.
Have you had overnight trips with Angie Molinets?
I have.
Have you shared the same room?
I guess if you're talking about a suite, you could probably say that.
Does Angie Molinex have a separate residence from you?
She does.
Has she stayed overnight at your residence?
She has.
How frequently does she spend the night at your residence in an average week?
She has had a renovation done to her house. And while the renovation was going on, she stayed in my house.
Okay. And this one's off the record. What is the address of Angie Molinex's home? Okay, and we're back on. Does Ms. Molinex have children?
She does.
If you could give me their names, that would be great.
Are we off the
Oh, I'm sorry.
Redaction again.
Off. Call me on that, sorry.
It's okay.
Okay, and we're back on. Are you helping to raise Angie Molinex's children?
Oh, sure.
Okay. Does Ms. Molinex work for the City of Cumming?
Oh, sure.
Does she receive, does she have any?
I'll say no, sir. She does do a lot of, I guess you'd call it legwork for me, since I don't have a city hall secretary. She does do a lot of secretarial work and background work for me.
Okay. Does she receive any financial remuneration from the City of Cumming for any of her services?
She receives no money, but I think she receives some insurance for her services.
Like health insurance?
Like a health insurance.
Okay. Do you know whether she gets dental too? And if you don't know, you don't know. That's fine.
I don't know what the insurance provides.
I don't really need more on that. Does she receive any financial remuneration from any companies in which you have a interest?
No, sir.
Does Ms. Molinex serve on any City of Cumming boards?
She serves on the Development Authority.
And how did she come to be a member of the Development Authority?
Appointed by the City Council.
Okay. Who put up her name to the City Council?
I can't answer that. I don't know.
Okay. Could it have been you?
It could have been me.
Okay.
It could very well have been me.
Okay. So.
But I don't remember.
As mayor, you're
the minutes will reflect it.
Okay. And as mayor, you're able to submit names for nominations to places like the Development Authority. Is that correct?
That any Development Authority or Health Board Authority or any other, the mayor can submit his recommendation.
Okay. And is she on any Forsyth County boards that you know of?
Don't know of anything, but I wouldn't think so.
Okay. Who is Brent Otwell?
He is an employee. No, he's not an employee. He's an appointed member on the planning board.
And do you know how he came to be appointed to the planning board?
Same way the others are, with the City Council.
Okay. Do you recall whether you submitted his name?
I could very well. I don't remember that.
Okay. And is he related to James Otwell, of whom we spoke earlier, do you know?
They may be distant relation, but they're not any close relation. They may be a distant cousin, but I'm not sure.
Okay. And is he a member of the Development Authority as well?
No, sir, I don't think so.
Okay. Has he been a member of the Development Authority, to the best of your knowledge?
The Development Authority is not very active, or hasn't been active, so I don't think so.
Okay. I think maybe the easiest way to do this next sector is for me to run off my understanding of the corporations you have an interest in and see if we're leaving off something. Okay? So I'm going to give you a list, and if you need a piece of paper to take some notes, let me know. But we're going to run through corporations or other entities or LLCs that you have or had an interest in. And my first goal is to see whether I'm leaving something off. Okay? So I've got 304 East Maple LLC, Canton Highway LLC, Ford Place LLC, Homer and Lily LLC, Highway 19 LLC, Kelly Mill Phillips LLC, Maple Street Intersection LLC, Otwell Manor LLC, Gravit Investments LLP, Three Way Listings LLC, Cumming Collision Center Inc., Gravit Properties LLC, Gravit Produce LLC, Ford Barbecue Restaurant LLC, and I understand some of these are now no longer in existence. Ridge Associates Inc., Cumming Group Associates Inc., and then I have two nonprofits that I'm going to be asking questions about. Concerned Taxpayers of Cumming Forsyth County Inc., or it's three, excuse me. Gravit, Everett, Davis, Georgia, FOP Lodge 66 Inc., and the Carolyn Gravit Memorial Fund. Are there other corporate entities or business entities that you have a financial interest in other than those that I listed?
I don't know of any, and I think some of those, I don't recognize some of those.
Okay. How much are you paid as mayor?
Pardon?
How much are you paid as mayor? Yearly, annual salary?
The charter calls for the mayor's salary is $1,000 a month.
And do you receive benefits as well?
I receive insurance.
Okay. Is there a pension?
It is a pension.
Okay. Do you receive life insurance, do you know?
Not aware of any life insurance.
Okay. We'll run through these. Let's start with 304 East Maple LLC. What is that?
That is a little small residential house.
Okay. And do you rent that house?
Try to.
Okay. And off the record for just a second. Okay, sorry, we're back on. So, and I may have already asked this question, so it's a place you rent out?
What place?
304 East Maple.
That's a residential.
Okay. And what
house, I'm thinking, that's the one.
Do you own that with others, or do you own that solely?
It's solely owned.
Now let's talk about Canton Highway LLC. What is that?
That could be, what's the address?
To be honest, I don't have it.
That's probably a business I have. It's got a couple of tenants in it, which one of them's a beauty shop and the other's a garage.
Okay. So you own the business property and you rent it out?
I do.
To
the business.
Okay. And is that something you fully own as well?
Yes, I build it.
Do you have, these are LLCs, do you have any partners on those?
No, sir.
Okay. Ford's Place LLC, what's that?
That is a place that I just referred to. I thought that might be the place you were talking about. That,
okay.
That's also on 20. That's has the beauty shop and the garage and the office, which is adjacent to my house.
This is kind of a general question, I'm not going to ask specifically, but I just kind of, it may save time to just ask it generally. Did you purchase a bunch of properties back in the day that you now own for residential leasing or commercial leasing?
Over the years, since I've was in the automobile business, I had opportunity through friends and family to purchase some property, if not a bunch of property as you referred to, because you put it all together acres wise, probably not less than 10 acres.
Sure. Okay.
But I didn't. I've never purchased a lot of property.
Okay. And other than your whopping salary as mayor of the city of Cumming, what are your primary sources of income?
I'm primarily retired on my rental property.
Okay. Homer and Lily LLC, L-I-L-Y.
I'm not sure of that. What's the address?
Six 22 Canton Road.
That would be probably the home that was formerly owned by Pauline Gravett, which was my aunt.
Okay.
And passed away, and these are names that was just some family names, and I just put that those names on an LLC.
Okay. And so you're the essentially the sole owner of that, and it's a residential.
It's a residential vacant place. There's no nothing in it.
Okay. Highway 19 LLC.
That Highway 19 LLC could be my automobile collision repair shop that I leased out.
Okay. So you're not an owner in that, you're a lessor?
I lease it out. I'm also the owner of it because that was my place before I leased it.
Okay.
Means he's the owner of the property, not of the business, isn't it, located there?
Thank you.
I'm not trying to interfere, but I could tell he was a little confused by your question.
No, that's helpful. That's helpful. And are you the sole owner of the property that is the property that's owned by Homer Lilly LLC?
Yes, sir.
And I'm sorry, I got us mixed up here. Are you the sole owner of the property where the collision business is, that is Highway 19 LLC?
Yes, sir.
Next one is Kelly Mill Phillips LLC.
That is a piece of property where it was purchased for rental by a family member on Kelly Mill Road, which has a commercial business, and I'm the sole owner.
Okay. So a family member purchased it and then sold it to you?
A family member has got a business in it.
Oh, I understand. I understand. Okay. And do they pay you rent?
They do.
Okay. Maple Street Intersection LLC.
That is a piece of commercial property.
Okay. And is there currently a business on that commercial property?
There's a business of a tent shop, glass tenting and super truck parts. Yes, sir.
Okay. And I assume you rent to them as well?
Yes, sir.
And you're sole owner in that?
Yes, sir.
Entity or that property?
Yes.
Otwell Manor LLC.
Yes, sir. That's a piece of property that I put under contract, and I am the owner of Otwell Manor.
Okay. So you're currently the owner, and you've got a contract for sale of that property?
I put it under contract, and I'm currently the owner.
Okay. And is there currently a establishment renting from you on that property?
There's not.
What is the closing date on that?
It's been closed.
Oh, okay. Gravett Investments LLP. What's that?
I'm not aware of that. Where's that at?
It's registered with the SEC. You're in active compliance with the SEC or with the Secretary of State's office on that.
Under my name?
Yeah, Gravett Investments LLP.
There's a lot of Gravetts.
Okay, we'll come back for that one.
Yeah, I'd like to know more about that. Okay. I may own something I don't know about.
Well, that would be wonderful. Three-Way Leasing LLC.
Three-Way Leasing LLC?
Mm-hmm.
I don't recognize that.
Okay. Just help you with your recollection, you would have had an interest in it in 2004.
Three-Way Leasing LLC.
Mm-hmm.
I think the only interest that, if it's any interest, that could have been a relative that's leasing a piece of property.
Okay.
I don't recognize that. I've never had anything to do with that company.
And this is an older one as well, Cumming Collision Center, Inc.
That's a piece of property that's leased to Cumming Collision. I don't own it.
Who is Dennis Elmer Gravett?
He's a relative.
Okay, well, what kind of a relative is he?
A nephew.
Okay. What about Nadine Gravett?
She may be a relative, but I can't, I don't know what's the address.
Okay. I should have asked you to bring your family tree. Rex Everett Gravett.
I don't know the relationship there. I don't, he's a real estate agent in Forsyth County.
Oh, okay. What about Gravett Properties LLC?
As I indicated, I'm not familiar with that. What's the address?
Oh, we were talking earlier about Gravett Investments LLP. I don't think we've talked about Gravett Properties LLC.
Not familiar with it.
Who is James Coyle? Do you know who James Coyle is?
Do I know who?
James Coyle, C-O-Y-L-E.
No, I don't know who that is.
Do you know Rusty Gravett?
Do I know Rusty Gravett?
Mm-hmm.
Is that a nickname?
I do not know. It's listed as his signature on Secretary of State's documents, but he may be going by Russell Gravett.
Not familiar.
Okay. Gravett Produce LLC.
I don't have an interest. I'm not. That's not mine.
Ford's Barbecue Restaurant LLC.
That goes way back, probably. Over 20 years ago that I had an interest in a barbecue restaurant.
And what happened to that barbecue restaurant?
The buildings were demolished.
Did it go out of business before the buildings were demolished?
It exchanged hands with I can't remember. It's been long, but it was still operating as a restaurant when the buildings were torn down.
Okay, we're getting close. Ridge Associates Inc.
That was something that I had. Years ago, I don't remember, but it's years ago, and it's no longer, it's out of business.
Cumming Group Associates, Inc.
That was a group of investors that I was involved in back some years ago, and it's no longer exist and last probably 50, I don't know, 10, 15 years, it's no longer exist.
Okay. You were a group of investors for commercial and residential investments?
Well, no, I said a group of investors. One of the main investor was, and you didn't ask this, but he no longer lives, was Mr. John Adderhole, who was the chairman of Lanier Bank and Trust.
Sure. Was one of the other investors Emery Lipscomb?
It could have been. It very well could have been.
Now I'd like to talk about three nonprofits. The Concerned Taxpayers of Cumming Forsyth County, Inc. What is that?
That was, what's the date on that?
It states that it was administratively dissolved in the 1990s.
That was about property taxes, that I was working with a group of people of trying to keep property taxes low.
Okay. And did the nonprofit just sort of go past its mission?
Well, there was no money in it, so obviously it didn't go anywhere.
Okay. Gravett Everett Davis, Georgia, FOP Lodge 66, Inc. What's your knowledge of that one?
None.
Okay. The Carolyn Gravett Memorial Fund for your wife. Is that a nonprofit that is still in operation?
It is in operation, and it is a nonprofit.
On the Secretary of State's office, it indicates that it was administratively dissolved in 2002. Help me understand why it's been defined as administratively dissolved by the Secretary of State's office.
I wasn't aware it was dissolved. My daughter's in charge of it, so I wasn't aware it was dissolved.
And it was still seeking scholarship, advertising scholarships as of 2013, isn't that correct?
There's an annual scholarship that comes out of the funds that's been placed in it.
Okay. Are you aware of whether it's listed as a nonprofit with the Internal Revenue Service?
I'm not aware because, like I said, my daughter's in charge of it.
Okay. And you are aware that there's a plaque in City Hall at the entrance where the fountain is for this nonprofit, isn't that correct?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Do you help raise funds for this nonprofit?
I've never helped raise any funds. I have put money into the nonprofit.
Okay. Do you put money in annually?
Not on an annual basis, but I put money in it periodically.
And I think you testified that, to your the best of your knowledge, your collective residential and commercial properties account for less than 10 acres?
I would think it probably does, yes, sir.
Have you recused yourself on all matters that would have any financial impact on each of the businesses we've discussed?
Explain.
Have you recused yourself from voting, if you were required to vote, on all matters regarding the entities we've discussed?
First of all, none of those entities I've ever come before the board, and second, the mayor doesn't have a vote.
Okay. Have you identified your financial interest in the, well, let me back up. Do you have to vote if there's a tie vote?
The charter provides for that.
Do you identify your financial interest if matters come up concerning these entities or any other entity in which you have a financial interest?
Absolutely.
Okay. So whether you have to vote or not, you identify your financial interest?
If I have a financial interest.
Okay. You've co-owned several properties with Emery Lipscomb, isn't that correct?
Fresh my memory.
There's a lot. You sold a property to Roy Otwell Enterprises, Inc. You purchased a property from Emery Lipscomb, and it was deeded over to both you and Emery Lipscomb, along with John Adderholt. And I'm just doing this to try to refresh your recollection. You and Emery Lipscomb transferred property to Judy Tatum. Is Judy Tatum related to Chief Tatum?
I'm not aware of it, of transferring any property to Judy Tatum.
Okay. Who's Gerald Blackburn?
He's a city manager.
Okay. Do you recall purchasing a property with him, there's a warranty deed at least, from Phoenix Land and Investments, Inc.?
When was that?
It would have been in 1988.
Not in the city of Cumming, I don't but I'm sure back 20 some odd years ago, it looks like, we were involved in a piece of property that's outside the city of Cumming.
Okay. And was he city manager back then?
Gerald Blackburn.
Yes.
Yes.
Okay. I've got another property that you co-owned with him that you had a transaction with Cumming Sawney Inc. Do you recall that? And this is with Gerald Blackburn, the city manager. Well, this would have been at the same time, 88.
Objective form.
It could have been a piece of property that it brought, but I can't recall it right off. But what was the location?
All I've got is the plat description. I'm sorry. I don't have that. Then I'll give you the years for these because I think it might be helpful. There's a transaction between Ridge Associates, Inc. and the purchaser along with Emery Lipscomb. In 1989.
Objective form.
Do you have any recollection of that?
89?
Yeah.
It could have been. Could very well have been a piece of property, but I'm not aware of what it was at the time. Okay. Right now.
And there's one in 89 from your wife to you, Emery Lipscomb, and John Adderholt. Do you know what that is?
Objective form.
1989.
Objective form.
I'm sorry, what's the objective form?
Just that, I mean, I don't know what you're looking at. The mayor doesn't know what you're looking at. The way you're framing your question is assuming that that document is accurate and that these transactions actually took place. I think some of your questions were more of the nature of, do you recall a transaction such as opposed to,
okay,
this transaction happened, do you remember it?
Yeah, I'm just asking action. For his recollection on each of these.
I don't recall.
Okay. There's one, and this is dated 1992, with Ford's Body Shop that we discussed previously. And the transfer of the lien is to the Forsyth County Tax Commissioner. Do you have any recollection of that?
That was where I had my business. I would assume that that was a loan that was made, and it was a transfer. I'm not sure, but that's my recollection.
A loan that was made by whom?
Forsyth County Bank.
You indicated that you know Emery Lipscomb, that you've had financial relationships with him. Is that correct?
Explain.
You've had financial relationships with Emery Lipscomb over the years?
Like how?
You've co-owned property together?
We've had some property that we owned together, yes, sir.
Okay. Approximately how many properties have you owned with Emery Lipscomb?
I'm not aware.
Okay. Has Emery Lipscomb ever given you a loan?
No, sir.
Have you ever given Emory Lipscomb a loan?
No, sir.
Are you still friends with Emory Lipscomb?
I hope so.
Do you play golf together? Do you play golf?
No, sir.
Okay. Does it come over to your house?
No, sir.
Okay. Was your relationship primarily a financial relationship or a friendship, or both?
Was a relationship a friendship basis? It was a friendship, and by virtue of the relationship with the property, it was financial.
Okay. Were you surprised when he was arrested and convicted of bank fraud?
I didn't know that at the time.
Did you have any causes for concern that he might be involved in illegal activity prior to his arrest?
Objection. Can you point to me and articulate how this is reasonably calculated to lead to the discovery of admissible evidence when I understand Mr. Lipscomb's arrest was sometime in the 1970s and we're here about a case that originated in 2012?
I'm not going to spend a lot of time on it, but I'm allowed to explore it. It's also not a proper objection under our agreement, but you can go ahead and answer.
Question.
Did you have any reason to believe or cause for concern that he might be involved in illegal activity prior to his arrest?
Never.
And did you use him as your personal attorney at any time?
He has done some personal work for me. Okay.
Have you consulted with him regarding any issues in your capacity as mayor of the city of Cumming?
No. Okay.
Have you ever traveled with Emory Lipscomb outside of Forsyth County?
I think I could say yes because I think we've been to dinner outside Forsyth County.
Have you ever traveled overnight with Emory Lipscomb?
Have I traveled overnight?
Yeah.
I have.
Okay. Do you know where you went? Recall?
I think it was fishing.
Out of state?
I'm saying to Steinahatchee, Florida, maybe.
And this one's off the record, or off the video record, excuse me. What businesses receive their correspondence through P.O. Box, I believe you own, is that correct?
My local mail comes to there.
Okay. Do any businesses receive mail through that P.O. Box?
Business that I'm involved in, most of it does. Some of it comes to my mailbox.
Okay. We're back on. So. And you lived in Cumming in 1987, correct?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Where were you during the Civil Rights March on January 24th, 1987? Do you recall?
Right here.
Okay. Right here.
In the middle of it.
Were you involved in the negotiations concerning that march?
Not further negotiations, but involved in appointing people for negotiations.
Okay. And there were two marches that occurred. One was a small march and then one was a larger one thereafter, correct?
I can only relate to the one in the city of Cumming.
Okay. Was that the big one with thousands of people, or was that the small one with maybe 100 people?
It was the larger one.
Okay. And where were you during the occurrence of the march? If you can recall.
I was in adjacent buildings surrounding the march.
And did you have a role for the city of Cumming during that march?
A role, explain.
Were you supposed to be coordinating with law enforcement officials in some capacity? There were state and federal officials at that point. I'm just trying to figure out if you had some role you had to play.
We were meeting with the state and federal officials, and as a public servant, whatever role you want to assume I played, we were trying to make sure there was it was safe.
So were you aware of the first march that occurred, the smaller march?
I think everybody was aware of everything, yes.
And you weren't present during that march?
It wasn't in Cumming.
Okay.
And the answer is no.
Okay. Did you see the Oprah Winfrey broadcast concerning that march?
Question.
Did you see the Oprah Winfrey broadcast concerning that march, to the best of your recollection?
I saw parts of it.
Did you have some impressions from what you saw?
No.
Do you have some impressions of either of the marches?
It was an unfortunate accident. It shouldn't have happened.
What was unfortunate?
The march was unfortunate.
What was unfortunate about it? You have a negative feeling about it. I'm just trying to understand why you have a negative feeling.
Well, it was an issue that the city of Cumming had nothing to do with. So it's unfortunate that it had to be used as a battleground. Have this situation happen and somebody get hurt.
Okay. And what was your understanding of the issue that was involved in that march?
It was more racial than anything, and the racial issues were caused at that time by none coming or Forsyth County people.
Were the racial issues caused by Hosea Williams?
I don't see that being the cause of it.
Okay. What was the cause?
Some racial issues from things that happened many years ago, maybe 100 years ago, or the Civil War, that seemed to be discussed that frankly we knew nothing about, and the people that was involved, as I said earlier, wasn't Cumming or Forsyth County people.
Okay. In your view, was Forsyth County integrated in 1987?
Jerry, I'm going to object to this. I've given you a lot of latitude, but you're right, we agreed to reserve all objections. That doesn't prohibit me from making objections, even though they're reserved. This deposition is related to an event which took place in 2012. You're asking about events that occurred approximately 30 years ago. Mm-hmm. I ask you to articulate for me how these questions are reasonably calculated to lead to the discovery of admissible evidence in this case. It is a discovery deposition.
Yeah.
It is not a smear campaign.
I know.
It is not an opportunity for you to ask questions that have nothing to do with what could lead to admissible evidence in this case. And I object to it. And I'm asking you repeatedly, tell me, this isn't background. This has nothing to do with this case. So please articulate that reason for me, or move on, one of the two.
I'm almost moved on. So far, we've covered areas about family relationship. We've covered areas about sources of income. We've covered areas about properties owned. All of these issues were covered in Ms. Tisdale's deposition. I'm spending 5 minutes on one event.
It happened in the 1980s.
Yes. So tell me, to do with this litigation.
Tell me how that is reasonably calculated to lead to the discovery of admissible evidence.
If you could repeat the question. I've only got a few more minutes, but I'm just
well, I'm asking you on the record, tell me your legal reasoning, because if you can't articulate it, then I'm going to ask you to move on, and I'm going to instruct the client not to answer any more questions about this.
If you want to do that, that's in violation of our agreement.
It is not in violation
of our
agreement.
I'm not required to give you an explanation.
This is clearly out of the bounds of what has anything to do with this lawsuit. A civil rights dispute from the 1980s has nothing to do with what happened on April 17th, 2012 at a Cumming City Council meeting. And at this point, it's becoming clear that this line of questioning is just intended to intimidate and harass the mayor as opposed to discover any evidence which could have any
basis
for
litigation. This is my last question in this area, if you'll let me complete the question. And if you want to call the judge and say that you object to one question, go ahead.
I've objected repeatedly to this, and I'm trying to give you leeway. I'm trying to be considerate.
This is our, as I said, this is our last question.
Let's hear what the question is.
And you can repeat the question. Did you believe that Forsyth County was integrated in 1987?
Same objection. Answer if you can.
I will answer, and I would suggest check the population census, and that'll be the answer that you can find.
Fair enough. Are you a member of the Masons?
I'm not.
Do you go to church?
I don't. I'll reframe that. I do, but I don't regularly go. Not like I should.
And where do you regularly go to church?
Non-denominational.
Where is it located at?
It's located, we have several of them in the county, but I'm a Baptist faith, okay. but I attend different churches when I go.
Okay. Do you normally go for holidays, mostly Easter, Christmas, those sorts of things, or do you?
No.
Okay. Have you ever been a Mason?
No, sir.
How often, sort of apart from the city council meetings, do you see the other members of the city council? Where you're interacting with them, I'm not just saying seeing them on the street.
I mostly see them at city council meetings. When we have a department head meeting that we publicly announce if we're going to have it, sometimes a couple of them might come to that, and I see them at a employee meeting.
Okay.
And maybe a Christmas party, but we don't social.
Do you ever go out to breakfast, lunch, or dinner?
No,
or
sir.
Anything?
No, sir.
And trying to think of how to phrase this question, but basically the city council people have been members of the city council for an awfully long time, right?
They have.
Okay. Who's the most recent new member of the city council?
That would be John D. Pugh.
And do you recall when he was first elected?
I think it was a special election after the passing of Gabe Dukas, who was on the city council.
And about what year was that? I'm just trying to get a sense.
I'm thinking it was in the 90s, but I'm not sure.
Over the past 2 years, can you recall there being any dissenting votes on land transactions?
Explain.
Where there was a split vote on a purchase or sale of a land transaction, what's come to city council?
I don't recall. The minutes were reflected.
But you don't recall any?
Don't recall.
Just a couple of questions about the Forsyth County Commissioners. Do you know most of the Forsyth County Commissioners?
Yes.
Okay. You met them all probably by now, right?
Yes.
Okay. Are you friends with any of the members of the Forsyth County Commission?
With any?
Yeah.
I would. Maybe you can define friends.
Sure, sure. Have you had any of the Forsyth County Commissioners to your house?
No, sir.
Have you had breakfast, lunch, or dinner with any of the Forsyth County Commissioners?
Yes, sir.
Who?
Brian Tam would be the one that would come to mention first.
Okay. Have you ever vacationed with any of the county commissioners?
No, sir.
Did the city council vote on what is the schoolhouse building?
Schoolhouse.
The schoolhouse building? Where Tam's backstage
okay,
is?
Okay.
What is that?
That's one of the first schools that was built in the early 1920s. That was purchased by the city of Cumming from the Board of Education for the purpose of restoration. Okay. And today it holds the memorabilia and artifacts from early periods of the 1900.
Sorry, and by the way, if you need to take a break, I may not have mentioned that, but if
no, I have drainage in my throat and I had surgery on my throat and I have drainage, so it is to where I can.
Well,
but anyway,
we can certainly take a break whenever
okay.
You want.
I'm okay. But today it contains basically a museum of a lot of things over of 100 years, and it contains a restaurant.
Okay. And that's Tam's backstage?
It is.
And that's owned by Brian Tam?
I'm not sure that it's Brian Tam.
Okay, so either he or his wife or something?
It's one of them.
Okay. And is there a rental arrangement between the city of Cumming and Tam's backstage?
It is.
Okay. How much does Tam's backstage pay to rent its facility within the schoolhouse building?
The records would show. I'm not sure.
You have no idea of how much?
I don't.
Is your recollection that it's commensurate with market rates?
When it was negotiated, yes, sir.
Okay. How long has TAMS Backstage been located in the schoolhouse building?
Ever since the restoration, I mean, that's been probably I can't go to the years. I'm not, you get my age, years flies by, so I'm not sure how many years, but he's been there since the restoration.
Okay. And do you eat there with any frequency?
No.
Okay. Do you pay your bill when you eat there?
Always.
Okay. And you don't have any ownership in?
No, sir.
TAMS Backstage. Okay. Who sets the agenda for the city coming public meetings?
After meeting with department heads and seeing what needs to be on the agenda, the mayor's responsible for setting the agenda.
Okay. Do you actually draft it, or how does that work?
It's drafted, put out for the public day before the meeting.
Okay. You just said you're responsible. I was just trying to figure out whether you personally draft the agenda or whether somebody else does it, or how that works.
I don't personally draft it, no.
Okay. How, since you're responsible for it, how is it developed? I'm just trying to understand.
After it's put together, with the department heads, his request will be put on the agenda. Manager, the assistant manager, and the secretary will go over it. And we usually proof it for the press.
Sorry, you proof it for the press?
It goes out, I think, required to get it out 24 hours or the day before the meeting.
Okay. When the agenda is put together, do you identify executive sessions that will probably need to occur?
The executive session is not identified on the agenda. It only comes about at the meeting and whether it's necessary or not.
Okay. And who determines whether an executive session is necessary?
I think the attorney, along with the council, would make that decision during the meeting.
Okay.
Prior to the meeting.
Is there a public vote to go in executive session?
At the council meeting?
I'm sorry. Yeah.
There would be a public vote. To go into, not a public vote, a vote of the council.
Okay.
But I'm sure there has been votes when I just called for an executive session based on the advice of council.
Okay. So if I have this correctly, sometimes you have a discussion with city council before the meeting and make some decision to go into executive session.
I usually don't see the council before the meeting.
Oh, okay. So then there's, if I'm understanding this, and correct me if I'm wrong, there's two ways it happens. One is the council for the city of Cumming indicates a need for an executive session and then you go into it, or you indicate that there's a need for an executive session and then you go into it.
And could I just, a couple of these questions, we've said council, which is spelled CIL as well as SEL, and I want to make sure we're differentiating between,
sure,
maybe we could say his
attorney.
Conversation with
attorney.
The city attorney versus the city council,
yeah.
Because a number of his questions, I'm not sure, or your questions and his answers could be interpreted one,
sure,
way or the other. So if you don't mind cleaning
that up, I
will. I think
and,
that would be
and
appropriate.
And let's strike those questions, actually. Let's start with...
If you could start over,
okay,
and just call,
okay,
me the city attorney,
sure,
if you will,
no,
as opposed to
that makes sense.
Counsel. It's just confusing.
Okay.
Thank you.
So one method, if I understand your testimony, and I've probably confused it a little bit, but one method of going into executive session is that the city attorney advises you of the need, and then you go into executive session. Is that correct?
That could be one method. And if that's the case, the city attorney would probably, when I ask him if is there a need for an executive session, he'd say there are a need.
Okay.
There is a need. If, for instance, I may have something that we need to talk about in executive session.
Sure.
And I would exercise that privilege to have an executive meeting.
Okay. So, and that was the second method that I understood, is that you as the mayor would have a reason to go into executive session, you would announce the need for an executive session.
It correct? Could be that a while.
Okay. But there's not a vote of city council to go into executive session, as I understand it.
There has been.
Okay. So that sometimes occurs, sometimes doesn't occur.
That's probably the case.
Okay. And if there's a vote, then it's reflected in the minutes of the meeting, I guess?
It would be.
Okay. When did Cumming first begin filming its own city council meetings?
The ribbon for the city hall was cut October the 15th, 2002. And shortly after, an IT employee was hired to take care of that. And I'm not sure what the date or even the year would be, but it was shortly after 2002.
Okay. And why did the city of Cumming decide to film their own meetings?
I think probably that we needed it in the records for maintaining proper accuracy of our meeting.
Would you or members of the council review the video at some point then, if there was some question about what had occurred?
If there was some question,
let me strike that, because is the video used in order to develop the minutes for the meeting?
No.
Okay. Then let me return to my question. Would the mayor or members of the city council sometimes review the video to refresh their recollection as to what might have occurred?
It could be that.
Okay.
But the minutes of the meeting is taken by the clerk.
Do you know whether the clerk sometimes reviews the video of the meeting that's taken by the Cumming City Council?
I've never seen him, but I'm sure he probably would.
Okay. And let's just give him a name. Who's the clerk?
That's Jeff Honey.
Okay. Do you make that film publicly available, the video of the meetings?
It's publicly available. It's a property of the City of Cumming.
Sure, it's a public record.
Yes.
My question was more directed to, do you put it on your website?
I don't think so. No.
So the reason you film the meetings is if there's a question about what occurred, then you've got the video to look back at. Is that a fair statement? I don't mean to mischaracterize your testimony, but that's my understanding.
If there's questions about the meeting or answer that came up in the meeting, excluding what was on the agenda, yes, we would look at the video.
Did you know Ms. Tisdale before the incident that is the subject of this lawsuit?
I've never properly been introduced to Ms. Tisdale.
Okay. So you hadn't met her prior to that meeting?
I had seen her, but I had never been introduced to her.
Okay. And where had you seen her before?
County Commission meeting.
Okay. And did you observe her filming the County Commission meetings?
very well could have been.
Have you ever reviewed online or otherwise focused on Forsyth?
I haven't.
Okay. Never reviewed that.
I haven't.
How about, it's called About Forsyth. Have you ever
I haven't.
Never reviewed that.
No.
Okay. Has anyone ever forwarded you things from Focus on Forsyth or About Forsyth?
They have.
Okay. Have you read them when they were forwarded to you?
Maybe. Partially.
Okay. Do you recall having reviewed anything on from Focus on Forsyth or About Forsyth about the incident that's the subject of this lawsuit?
No, sure. Okay.
New police chief and assistant police chief in January of 2012. Why the new police chief and new assistant police chief? Why was there a change in the police chief and assistant police chief in January of 2012?
A health issue.
Okay. Health issue with the then police chief, correct?
Yes.
Okay. Did you play any role in the naming of the police chief and assistant police chief?
Like, what kind of role?
My understanding from the testimony the other day is that the city manager kind of makes the ultimate call. But I wondered what role you played. Were you involved in the discussions? Were you involved? Did you make recommendations?
The city manager and assistant city manager would interview and do the legwork, and it would come to me to be put on the agenda. I think Chief Tatum was put on the agenda because he was the assistant chief. And the council voted on that, based on that.
Okay. Is there normally one officer from the City of Cumming Police Department at each meeting for security purposes?
Object form.
There always has been at least one.
Okay. And that's normally the chief, is that correct?
As most of the time, yes, sir.
Okay. And if the police chief is away for some reason, then it might be the assistant police chief or even another member of the department. Fair
that's
to say?
Correct.
Okay. And is it your understanding that during the course of a city council meeting, you as mayor are responsible for the conducting of that meeting?
It's my understanding.
Okay. And is it your understanding that you as mayor have the power to remove a person from the meeting if necessary and consistent with state law, state federal law?
Objection form to the extent you're not an attorney and can't offer legal.
Yeah, I'm not asking for legal conclusions. I'm just understanding of powers.
Explain, remove.
If a person was engaged in activity that gave you the lawful power to remove them, say they were disruptive or something, if that's allowed, then would you have the power to order their removal?
The lawful power of what I think would be lawful.
Yeah, yeah.
I think I could request that to be done.
Okay, and you'd normally request the law enforcement officer who was there on that day to do that.
They would be the ones that would be in charge.
Okay, and you'd request that from, you know, if there's multiple law enforcement officers, any one of them would be empowered to execute that order, correct?
Multiple, whether it would be city, county, state, federal, whatever officer would be at a meeting would be responsible.
Okay. And the same thing with camera, to the extent that someone is videotaping and it's not allowed under state or federal law, would you have the power to order the removal of a camera?
Same objection.
If I thought it was legal,
yes.
Or illegal.
If you thought it was legal to have them have the camera removed, would you have the power to order that removal?
Same objection.
If it was legal,
yeah,
in my mind,
right.
Certainly, I wouldn't have the officers to interact with anybody about doing something that you say might be illegal.
Right. I think we're on the same page. I mean, assuming you think that it is legal to remove a camera, then you have the power to order law enforcement officers to remove that camera.
At the time, yes, sir.
Okay. Do you recall any prior incidents with people attempting to videotape either Cumming City Council meetings or other meetings involving the City of Cumming?
Prior to April of 2012.
I'm sorry, prior to April.
Thank you.
Of 2012, yes.
That's never been an issue with the city before.
Okay. Do you recall an incident where there was a lost meeting where somebody attempted to videotape?
At a city council meeting?
It wasn't a city council meeting. It was another meeting involving the City of Cumming.
I think you got to give me some information. We had a lot of SPLOST meetings, but...
It was a town hall meeting regarding SPLOST. S-P-L-O-S-T, sorry.
When was it?
I'll just object to the question that it seems facts, not evidence.
Okay. 2008, about 2008. And if you don't recall, you don't recall. We've just got some documents about it.
All I can recall of the 2008 SPLOST election, that there were a lot of meetings.
Okay. But you never heard anything about a problem with a camera recording a SPLOST
no.
town hall meeting?
No.
Had you reviewed the Open Meetings Act before the incident that's the subject of this lawsuit? At all? I mean, I know there's two different versions.
I probably haven't.
Okay. Do you recall ever being provided from any source a book? It's a small red book. It's from the Georgia First Amendment Foundation and the Attorney General's Office concerning what the Open Meetings Act says.
Was I provided that book?
Yeah, prior to the incident or subsequent.
By who?
By any source. I mean, you might have had it at a educational meeting. You might have had somebody send it to you. Just, do you remember ever getting a copy of some book that described the Open Meetings Act that would have been read in cover and paper and cover?
I don't remember having that book.
Okay. Do you attend any trainings regularly for mayors or other public officials?
I have.
Okay. Tell me a little bit about those.
Objective form.
Are they at the University of Georgia?
They have been.
Okay. Do you recall any of those trainings talking about the Open Meetings Act?
I've never been to as far as a seminar on the open meetings, and I'm sure they've had it. But due to the fact that a lot of those meetings are held in Jekyll Island,
right.
We don't take that long drive and expense city money going down there. So a lot of those meetings where they discuss this, I don't attend.
Okay, so those are like the meetings of the Association of City and County Commissioners or some entity like that?
Oh, it's Association of Georgia Municipal Association.
Thank you. All right. Have you reviewed the Open Meetings Act since this incident?
I have.
Okay. And have you reviewed the provisions specifically dealing with recording of meetings?
I have.
Have you reviewed both the language prior to this incident and the language that was in effect during this incident?
I'm not sure about before, but I can tell you since.
Okay. I tell you what, we're at a good stopping point for at least a short break.
Sure.
And then, we'll be talking about the incident. So why don't we take a break? Does that sound good?
That's great.
Okay. What time are we at?
11:15.
Okay.
You want to go straight through and
I think we can go straight through. Okay, we can go back on whenever y'all are ready.
Yes, sir.
Okay. Do you recall Ms. Tisdale videotaping a state of the community address?
State of the community? Uh-huh. For who?
You were one of the speakers, and it was called the state of the community address.
No, I don't recall.
Okay. And you don't recall your daughter speaking to you and pointing out Ms. Tisdale videotaping that state of the community address?
My daughter speaking to me about that.
Right. At the meeting.
No, I don't recall my daughter speaking to me about Ms. Tisdale.
Okay. It was at Lanier Technical College. Does that refresh your recollection?
No, it doesn't.
Pete Amos and Darla Light spoke. Does that refresh your recollection at all?
They spoke at the State of the Union.
Okay. But you still don't recall Ms. Tisdale videotaping or your daughter speaking to you about Ms. Tisdale videotaping?
I don't recall seeing or speaking to Ms. Tisdale, okay. And I don't recall my daughter mentioning Ms. Tisdale.
Okay. Let me show you what's been marked as Plaintiff's Exhibit 6. Sorry, I need more copies of that one. What is that? You know what that is?
Well, it looks like a connecting of communities flyer with a media group with my picture on it.
Okay.
But I've never seen it.
What do you know what Appen Media Group is?
No.
Is that a correct quote from you?
It could very well be. Over a period of time, I look at a lot of things.
Do you subscribe to the Forsyth Herald newspaper?
I don't.
Okay. So you've never seen this before?
No, sir.
Did you have any discussions with anybody about this, I don't know if it's an advertisement or what. I don't know whether it's paid for as an advertisement. But did you have any discussion with anyone about this document?
I could very well have, but I didn't have a discussion with anyone relative to this picture here.
Okay.
It appears to me that somebody's took things out of context. This picture doesn't go with this.
Okay. Did you have any discussions with anyone about the need for or reason for placing this in the Forsyth Herald News?
It could very well have been.
You could very well have had discussions about the need for or reason for this being placed in the Forsyth Herald News?
No. I don't know for a reason that would have been placed in the Herald News. But I could have had a discussion about it, but not for the purpose of why it would be placed in a newspaper.
Okay, so if you had any discussions about it, it would have been subsequent to its publication? in the Forsyth Herald News?
Let me ask a question, just to make sure I understand. Was this document published in the Forsyth Herald?
Yeah, it's got the, I think at the top it says that, yeah.
Yes.
Yeah.
Okay, well, I mean, that looks like it's from the Forsyth Herald. I don't know whether it was published in the paper. I mean, are you representing that it was published on April 24th, 2013 in the Forsyth Herald?
Yeah, that's my understanding, yeah.
And I'm not questioning that. I just wanted to be clear on, because, I mean, this could be, for all I know, it's a flyer.
Oh,
you know,
I understand.
But if you're saying it was published on that date, I'm not questioning that. I've just never seen it before today either. So that, I just wanted to make it clear where you are telling us that this was published on April 24th, 2013 in the Forsyth Herald. And that's
my
obviously this is not a copy of the newspaper itself. It's a copy of a portion of a page from a newspaper.
Yes, yes, yeah.
Okay.
And my recollection is this has been produced previously in Discovery. All I'm really trying to understand is whether there were discussions that you had with anyone prior to the publication of this in the Forsyth Herald News about this. That is Plaintiff's Exhibit 6.
If there was any discussion on this nature, it happened at one of my meetings where I would have been in contact or close relation with whoever is working for the Herald, because I've never had a meeting to talk about this issue with anybody from Forsyth Herald. I've never had a meeting to talk about this issue.
Okay. Yeah, and I think I get where we're not communicating. You know, obviously, I think you've testified that this is probably a quote from you, but what I'm asking about is whether you had any discussions with anyone prior to this publication in the Forsyth Herald News about having this, that is, Plaintiff's Exhibit 6, placed in the Forsyth Herald News.
I've never seen that before.
Okay. And that's not quite my question. Was there any discussion with anyone about having this placed in the Forsyth Herald News prior to having it placed in the Forsyth Herald?
As I said, prior to this being placed in the Forsyth Herald,
right.
I don't know. I've never seen this before.
Okay.
So
I know you've never seen it before, but that doesn't mean you didn't have discussions with...
If there was any discussion, it was on a limited discussion, because this came about not by virtue of me sitting at the table talking about this issue. If I even discussed it, it was at a meeting, a regular meeting, where the Forsyth Herald reporter was and probably asked me a question about something. That would be the only time that this would ever come about. Did I explain that?
I think so. I'm going to ask a couple questions, but I think we're just not communicating.
Please do, because
yeah.
I think we're confused.
Yeah.
Maybe both of us.
This document, that is Plaintiff's Exhibit 6, was placed in the Forsyth Herald News. And my question is whether you had any discussions with anybody about having something to the effect of Plaintiff's Exhibit 6 placed in the Forsyth Herald before it was placed in the Forsyth Herald. Does that make sense?
I don't subscribe to Forsyth Herald. I don't read Forsyth Herald. This could have been done, but I don't know where it was talked about before it was put in or after it was talked about.
Okay, I think we're close enough. Okay.
I'm not.
Great.
And
we're just not communicating.
I
apologize.
But this, as I said, I never sit down at a table with a newspaper.
Or with Appen Media Group.
And that looks like I'm holding a Forsyth Herald, which that's a fiction of imagination, because that wasn't taken with me.
Oh, okay. So the photograph of you with the Forsyth Herald News is probably somehow doctored, because you've never had the Forsyth Herald News in your possession?
I have seen the Forsyth Herald, but I don't subscribe to it, and I've never sat down for this discussion
Okay.
with the Forsyth Herald.
Okay. Now what we're going to do is we're going to watch a video, and I'm going to have a few questions from the video. This is a second video. We'll submit it to the court reporter as a CD. And this is a Fox 5 interview you gave shortly after the incident. It's very short, but I've just got a couple questions about it.
Will this video be Exhibit 7?
This will be Exhibit 7, yes. Thank you. Okay. And if I can run through the whole thing, but actually he doesn't talk until 1 minute and 6 seconds. But you want to watch the whole thing.
Did you also want to tell the court reporter that she did not need to take down the audio from
that,
the...
Okay. Yeah, I told her previously.
Become
hard. Are we able to expand it? There we go. Can you hear it?
I can.
Can you see the
card? This is a copy of the letter Georgia Attorney General Sam Olin sent to the city of Cumming today. It spells out the possible fines for violating state sunshine laws and clearly states that Georgia law allows for no recording of public meetings, but it's still not so clear to Cumming's mayor. Take your hands off of me.
Nobody disputes the facts of what happened Tuesday night. The Cumming mayor, Fort Graven, banned Nydia Tisdale's camera from the city council meeting.
I thought it was a right thing to do.
Okay, you could stop right here. So at the time of this broadcast, you stated to the reporter that it was the right thing to do, meaning removing the camera. First question is, do you still believe it was the right thing to do to remove the camera?
No.
Answer, I just want to object that I believe what you said mischaracterizes what he said in the video.
I'm sorry, if you could correct
me. I think he said, I thought at the time it was the right thing to do,
okay.
Or something to that effect. The video says what it says, but I just wanted to
okay.
Clear that about that.
Yeah, and the first question is, do you now think it was the right thing to do to remove the camera?
At the time, April the 17th, I thought that was the right thing to do, the meeting night.
Right.
Today, I don't think I did the right thing.
Okay. And now we can, and that was at approximately 1:06.
I backed it up just slightly.
Yeah.
So.
Okay, now we can go forward.
Oops.
Today, I brought a copy of the Georgia Code to Mayor Fort Graven to show him the state sunshine law.
Oh, it's pretty obvious in the Georgia Code, though. It says visual sound recordings during open meetings shall be permitted.
Okay, if we can stop it there. And then we'll need to back it up so we can hear his response. At the time the reporter for Fox 5 provided you with a copy of the Open Meetings Act, had you at that point in time reviewed the Open Meetings Act provision about recording of meetings?
At the time, I was aware of what the sunshine law called for.
Okay. So when the reporter gives this to you, you had seen the language or talked to, and I don't want any discussions you had with your attorneys, but you had talked to somebody about what the contents of that provision said.
That happened a few days after the April 17th meeting, and I'm thinking maybe on a Wednesday or a Thursday, the 18th or 19th of April of 2012. And yes, I had reviewed the sunshine law.
Okay. And you stated on your first quote on this broadcast that at the time you believed it was the right thing to do. I think that's the language. Why did you, at the time, think it was the right thing to do?
On April the 17th, I get to my meeting, the city council meeting, about 5 minutes prior to 6 o'clock when the 5 minutes prior to the meeting.
Mm-hmm.
And I see your client, Miss Tisdale, with her tripod and video camera, standing in the first aisle, close to the front.
Mm-hmm.
She picks up her tripod and the camera and goes over to the center aisle toward the middle way or toward the back of the room.
Sure.
My first response was that we had several people at the meeting that night, and I thought, first of all, it could be a safety issue by traveling around with a tripod and a camera in the meeting room.
Mm-hmm.
And second of all, I didn't want any disruptions to the meeting. And that was the basis for asking her to turn the camera off and take the camera out, get out of the way.
Okay. When you saw the camera, did you know what type of camera it was?
I'm not familiar with cameras.
Did you know whether it could just videotape or video and sound record? You didn't know at that point, did you? Because you hadn't really looked at the camera, right?
I was just making assumptions that the camera was a video camera, and that's the only actions that okay. I was taking based on what assumptions that I made at the time.
Okay, so you didn't make any assumptions about whether it could also record sound or not at that time, or it didn't enter into your mind?
I didn't say anything about the sound. I just said you move your camera.
Okay. Okay.
I believe that's the words I said.
Was it possible, since you didn't observe the camera, or didn't take a close look at it, that it could only record video and not sound, or vice versa?
Objective form.
Is it possible?
Well, let me rephrase it. At the time you first observed the camera, or at any time during the incident, did you know whether the camera was on or off?
My assumption was that since your client, Miss Tisdale, had the camera in the to my right eye, and she was moving the camera around, was to get better angles to shoot to video the meeting. And my assumption was that she was videoing the meeting, and I made no other assumption.
Okay, and let's separate out assumptions from knowledge, because we can talk about both of them separately. And my first question was, did you know that she was recording? Not that you assumed it, but did you have a basis for knowing that she was recording one way or the other?
At that time?
At that time.
I didn't know that.
Okay.
But
you were assuming that she was recording.
But it's strange to walk around with a camera and it not being used in a meeting.
Okay. And at the time of the meeting, did you know whether the camera video recorded and audio recorded, or just video recorded? And I know what you might assume, but let's focus on what you knew first.
At that time, I didn't.
Okay. And at that time, you didn't know whether it was a still camera taking individual images or a camera that was taking moving images. You didn't know.
I had made the decision to remove it based on a safety issue and based on keeping my meeting in order. Okay. And that was the decision I made.
And you made that wholly apart from whether it was a video camera, audio camera, or a single image camera?
If it hadn't have been a camera, if it had been some other instrument, I would have probably still made the same decision.
Okay. We may need to back it up just slightly to, let's back it up to where he talks about the exact, so we can give the correct timestamp on it. Okay, stop. So for you, it's like 127 is what we were referring to previously. Now we're at 131. And go ahead and play. But we need to back it up again because I don't think we need to talk.
Tisdale was back at it with her camera, recording the Forsyth County Commission meeting. And visual and sound equipment. That's what visual sound equipment shall be permitted. Visual and sound equipment. That's what it may be permitted.
Okay, and that's at 133 about. You indicate that there's a gray area there. And if you could articulate what you meant by that.
I think when we, I wasn't aware that the video and or the audio and was both permitted at the time.
Okay.
So that was the gray area with me.
Okay.
Where both of them was permitted or where one was permitted, I didn't know. But that basically what was done wasn't based on the fact that the videoing. It was based on the safety issue and holding proper decorum at the meeting.
Okay. And you previously testified that you hadn't reviewed the Open Meetings Act or this provision prior to the prior to this incident, correct?
Prior to the April 17th meeting.
Okay.
I did afterward.
Okay. I don't think that there's anything more on this. Give us just a second. We're off the record. I think that was the...
Recording the Forsyth County Commission meeting and vowing to return to Cumming City Council.
I will be back to more city council meetings, most certainly, yes, and I will bring my video camera.
But the mayor stands by his decision.
Had the potential to be disruptive to the meeting. It could be a safety issue.
The public open meeting is an open meeting that cameras should be allowed according to Georgia law.
Well,
we can interpret it different.
And that's at 2:15 approximately. And you stated what you've stated today, that it was a safety or disruption issue. And then you stated something about interpretation. What did you mean by that?
My interpretation could be different from yours, maybe, or somebody else's.
Okay. Interpretation of what? Of the statute or what?
Of the alleged incident that occurred April 17th.
Okay. How could the interpretations differ? I'm trying to understand what you meant.
Well, I didn't interpret my feelings of the Sunshine Law that I was doing something wrong.
Okay.
At the time.
Did you receive any phone calls during the meeting that's the subject of this lawsuit?
Explain.
Did you receive any phone calls while this meeting was occurring that is the subject of this lawsuit?
Phone calls during our April 17th meeting?
Mm-hmm.
No, I didn't receive any phone calls during that April 17th meeting.
Do you recall saying something to the effect of, is the Attorney General calling about some illegal meeting?
That one at April 17th meeting.
That was at the following meeting?
That was the following meeting.
Okay.
And I do recall.
Okay. So at the following meeting in May of 2012, did you receive a phone call?
My phone was in my pocket,
mm-hmm.
and I neglected to turn my phone volume off during the meeting, and it rang. My phone started ringing.
Okay.
And I didn't receive a call, but I cut my phone off and said, jokingly, is this the Attorney General calling to that effect?
Okay. And did you say something?
But I didn't receive a phone call.
Okay.
And that wasn't at the April 17th meeting. That was a following. That was in May.
Okay. And did you reference, is this the Attorney General calling about an illegal meeting or something to that effect?
It could have been that.
Why is that a joke?
I think it'd be a joke for anybody to be calling during a meeting if it was legal.
Okay.
Asking, were we holding a meeting? So that's the joke part of it.
Who did call you? Do you know?
I don't know. I never did return the call if I looked.
Do you, if there's questions about the Open Meetings Act or how you should oversee a meeting, do you sometimes turn to the city attorney, not city council, but city attorney, to ask questions about some ambiguity in what you can and can't do?
Under the Open Meetings Act?
Under the Open Meetings Act, or, you know, anything regarding the conduct of the public meeting. Because there may be other issues.
I agree.
Yeah.
There's a lot of issues that legally affect any public meeting, not just the Open Meetings Act. So that's why I'm trying to differentiate when you're asking him about a legal issue that comes up during a city council meeting, or a legal issue that relates just to the Open Meetings Act, because I want his answer to be to whatever question you want asked.
Yeah, and I've got two areas.
Sure. So if you just differentiate or make it clear to him.
Sure.
Thank you.
One is, if there are questions about the Open Meetings Act, have you referred those questions to the city attorney? During the meeting, and then I'm referring to during the course of a meeting.
And is this prior to April 17th, or after, or during?
This is ever.
Ever.
Currently, and we'll define it more.
Since April 17th, I know to do it now because I'm not a lawyer.
Mm-hmm.
Prior to April 17th, the issues never came up, but periodically city attorney would suggest if we need executive session and the procedure that we would go through to go to executive session, and we still do that today.
Okay, and that's the procedure you identified earlier in your deposition, correct?
Yes.
Okay. Now, you indicated that subsequent to this incident, you have referred questions regarding the Open Meeting Act to the city attorney. If you could tell me about those.
I'll just instruct you that not to reveal privileged communications that you had with the city attorney.
And I guess we'd have a question about whether they're privileged communications if they're happening.
If it's something that was broadcast to an entire room full of people, opposed to something that he came up and privately told him. So if it's something that was confidentially, privately shared with you, that would be privileged. If it was something that was said loud enough for an entire room of people to hear, that would not be privileged.
Question again.
And I think we actually disagree with the scope of the privilege question, but I'm not going to get into it. I'm just going to ask him to identify the conversations that he's had of a more private nature. Is that fair? Not the contents of them, but we actually disagree with your interpretation of privilege during the course of a meeting. But my question was, going back, actually, will you help me?
Oh, goodness. Let's see. The only reason I'm having to use this is I just bought this and it's not translating.
And I can give it a shot if it's hard to rediscover it. Here, let me go ahead and take a shot. Yeah. My question was, subsequent to this incident, you had indicated that you conveyed questions to the city attorney about the interpretation of the Open Meetings Act, and I'm asking you to outline those instances. And if you talked about those instances in a way that other persons could hear, other than the city attorney and yourself, let's talk about those in some depth. If you only talked to the city attorney and no one else was in hearing, then I'd ask you to identify the times you've done that, but not the contents of your communication. Fair enough?
Yes, my only objection would be clarification would be, if you're asking about questions that were asked of me or Mr. Talent as city attorney during a city council meeting, I think that's absolute fair game and that there is no privilege. You can ask those questions. I can tell you, and you're free to ask him about this, that I have met with the mayor and city management staff about this issue and about this lawsuit.
Oh, sure.
Privately, on other occasions, and I want to caution him not to testify about those meetings or what we discussed in those meetings. I'm going to instruct you, Mr. Mayor, anything that you ask me about in a public meeting, you answer his question.
Okay.
Those are the ground rules that I would like to
suggest. And I completely agree, and if I didn't phrase it correctly, I was actually talking about what is discussed during a meeting.
Public meeting. No problem.
Okay.
No objection to that. Okay.
So let's try this again, sorry. So you'd indicated that subsequent to the incident that's the subject of this lawsuit, you had discussions in a public meeting with the city attorneys regarding the interpretation of the Open Meetings Act.
And I'm going to object to form because I don't think he said that. What I think he said is I would.
Oh.
Well, I don't think he said that we did. I think he said we would, as if you were giving him a hypothetical. If the issue came up now, he would ask us to respond. So maybe we should ask the first question.
That's fine. I misinterpreted. Have you had discussions with the city attorneys in a public meeting subsequent to this incident regarding the interpretation of the Open Meetings Act?
Prior to April 17th.
No,
since. Subsequent
okay.
to the incident. That's
yes, we have.
Okay. And if you could identify the topics and what you discussed, and this is only the discussions that you had in the public meeting with the city attorney regarding the interpretation of the Open Meetings Act.
The interpretations of the current open meetings.
Mm-hmm.
As it was signed on April 17th by the governor?
Yes.
Is that video and audio recording shall be permitted?
Sorry, let me stop you because I think we're...
What we discussed.
Okay. There was the incident that's the subject of this lawsuit. And now I'm asking you at each meeting subsequent to that incident. First, have you had at any of those meetings discussions with the city attorney about the interpretation of the Open Meetings Act?
And his question is for, just if I might, he's not asking you about executive session communications, although he can ask if we've had executive session and the dates that we've had it. But he's not asking you about the communication in executive session or what we have discussed in a private meeting. He's asking you about what happened at city council meetings. Did the Open Records Act ever come, or Open Meetings Act, ever come up in a city council meeting after April 17th where Kevin or I advised you? Is that fair?
No, that's fair. That's fine. Yeah.
And an open meeting.
Yes.
It hasn't.
Okay.
That's what I
thought. Sorry, we spent a lot of time coming to no place.
Yeah, but I didn't want to testify for him.
Sure.
I was trying to get to the truth to come out and make sure he was understanding your question.
Yeah. No, fair enough. Okay. My second category is a little bit difficult, more difficult, unfortunately. Have, subsequent to this incident, have you had discussions with the city attorneys in a public meeting about any restrictions you can or should place on citizens who attend the meetings?
Prior to April 17th?
Yes.
No.
Subsequent to April 17th.
And again, your question Same is limited question. To just the, during an open meeting.
You want me to repeat it?
You've asked the same question before and after. Is that your same question?
Yeah.
And
this is questions. Well, let me repeat the question just to make it real clear. Subsequent to the incident that's the subject of this lawsuit, at meetings of the city council, have you had discussions with the city attorneys regarding restrictions that can or should be placed on citizens in attendance at the public meeting?
I can't recall that it came up in a public discussion, but I can recall issues that pertained to where the cameras would be placed at City Hall since April 17th.
Okay, and I'm assuming that those are going to be into confidential territory. Okay.
You're free to ask him about the policy, which was, of course, issued.
Yeah.
I think that's already an exhibit.
Yeah, and we're going to talk about that. Okay, well, why don't we ramp up the video? We're going to run through the video now. And talk about a few things there.
Is this the Exhibit 4 video?
Yes.
Do you want the full version, the 4-minute one, the longer one, the full length?
I think so,
yeah.
That's what we used last time, right?
Okay, so the first 2 minutes, not much of anything is happening, so... I can fast forward it. Yeah,
let's go to where the actual incident starts.
Well, the gavel starts about 2:05 or so.
Stop for a minute.
Respectfully, Mayor, Georgia.
A few questions about that. You said it was the I believe you used the word policy of the city to not allow cameras. Where did that policy derive from?
It derived from me. It's my policy.
Okay. And you were empowered to make that policy as mayor overseeing the meeting, correct?
I felt like I was.
Okay. And had that policy been written anywhere?
No.
Okay. Had you conveyed that policy in a public meeting ever before?
Yes.
Okay. Did you decide on that policy at that moment when you saw the camera?
No, sir.
So you had previously thought about whether cameras should be allowed in the meeting other than the city's own cameras?
That wasn't your question. Your question was, did I, the policy at that moment, the issue of removing the camera was, as I said, a safety issue and keeping order in the meeting.
Okay. You stated it was a policy that the camera needed to be removed. You didn't indicate anything about safety or disruption or moving the camera.
That was my fault. That's exactly right.
Okay. So your testimony now is that you would have allowed the camera if it had been moved to a different place, perhaps? I'm trying to understand.
What I know now, that I was wrong making that decision on April 17th, the meeting.
Okay. And at the time, I want to put you in your head at the time you made this statement, which is 227 on the video. At that time, are you now stating that you would have allowed the video if it was in a different place?
I'm saying my decision was wrong. The location later, after April 17th, was made for the location for the tripods and cameras to be placed.
Okay. And you directed Chief Tatum to remove the camera, correct?
At some point, that happened.
Is that in what we just heard? You know, we can play it back if you want.
That's what I said. Yes, it's sometime during that statement that I did ask Chief Tatum to remove the camera and the tripod.
Mm-hmm. And it was your understanding that you were empowered to do that as mayor overseeing the meeting, correct?
I thought I was.
And that instruction would apply to all, there were several law enforcement officers there, correct?
Several.
Several law enforcement officers there at that
like
meeting?
Like being several, two, three,
there
four?
There were three, I believe.
Okay.
There was Officer Hester,
okay.
Chief Tatum, and yes. Deputy Chief Cook, correct? To the best of your knowledge.
I think. Normally we have one officer, but I think that night we had on the agenda recognizing completing a police course, one of the officers, so that would require him to be there. So you're probably right. It was probably three or four officers.
Okay. And in ordering the chief to remove the camera, and that would apply to all the other officers too if they were needed, correct?
Object four.
I think when I give a directive to the officer, if he needed help, obviously the other officers would be there.
Okay, and the directive would apply to them as well. That's all I'm asking.
I didn't say that.
I know you didn't say that, but you ordered the chief of police.
That's what the record shows, yes, sir.
And if the chief of police said to Officer Hester's, you do it, that would be consistent with your instruction, correct?
I would hope the chief would obey the law, whatever the laws are,
okay.
That as he knows them.
Okay. And your understanding is that the Chief Tatum can order his officers to do things within the bounds of the law, correct?
That would be my understanding of the police officer, yes, sir. And not only the chief, but the other officers also. The things they would do would be within the law.
Okay. And your understanding is that you as mayor can order Chief Tatum to do things within the bounds of the law to ensure the smooth working of a public meeting, right?
Object form.
If I think I'm within the law, I would ask the chief to address that issue.
Okay. Now, after you issue this instruction to Chief Tatum, let's go ahead and go with the video. We may have specific questions about what happens next.
Continue.
Sunshine Park. No, sir. Georgia law, I'm exercising my right as a citizen to record this meeting. Sir, this is an open and public meeting. I have a right by Georgia law to film this meeting. Ask Dana Miles. Ask your counsel.
Okay, stop.
Ask Dana Miles.
We're at 3 minutes approximately. Now, at this point, Ms. Tisdale has asserted that she has the right under Georgia law to record this meeting. And she requests that you consult with the city attorney, Dana Miles. Do you do that?
I didn't do it.
Why did you not do that?
In my mind, I thought I was right at the time.
Okay. Is it true that you mouthed to the city attorney at one point, how much is this going to cost me?
No.
Did you communicate with the city attorney at the meeting at all concerning this incident?
At
the meeting?
The meeting.
Concerning this incident, not other communication?
No, I didn't.
Sure of that?
At the meeting?
Yes.
April 17th?
Yes.
At the public meeting?
Yes.
No.
Certain you didn't say how much is this going to cost me?
No.
Certain you didn't mouth it to him?
No.
Just so it's clear, when you say no, are you saying no, you didn't mouth it to him, or no, you're not certain whether you mouthed it to him or not?
Okay.
I just want to make sure the record's clear about that.
Are you 100% certain that you did not communicate, either verbally or by mouthing the words, to the city attorney, how much is this going to cost me, or something to that effect?
Not at April 17th. I didn't discuss that.
Okay. That's a dirty line privilege. Okay, let's. I mean, maybe done with the video, but let's go ahead and go. Make sure.
I have a right by Georgia law. There will be a complaint filed with Georgia Attorney General not allowing me to film this meeting.
Okay.
Take your hands off of me. Take your hands off
of me. Okay, stop right there. At this point where Ms. Tisdale says, take your hands off of me, do you have sight of whether Chief Tatum or Deputy Chief Cook, in fact, have their hands on Ms. Tisdale?
Never seen hands on Ms. Tisdale.
Did you hear her make that statement?
I hear that.
Did you correct or indicate that you didn't see Chief Tatum or Chief Cook have their hands on her while she was saying that the hands were on her?
As a matter of fact, I leaned over and all where I could see more clearly, and there was no hands on Ms. Tisdale that I saw.
As you saw Ms. Tisdale going to the back of the room with the officers, did you think at that time to indicate to the officers Ms. Tisdale is allowed to attend this meeting, or to state to the officers that Ms. Tisdale is allowed to come in without her camera or with her camera turned off?
Did I think that?
Yeah.
No.
Okay. Did you see Ms. Tisdale go around the wall at any point?
No.
To the outside area. Okay. And let's just look at this for a second. This is what's been previously marked as Plaintiff's Exhibit 2 and Defendant's Exhibit 1. Let me just give you a sense. The layout was drafted by Ms. Tisdale. We've now, as you saw in the depositions yesterday, had the officers place themselves. And they've indicated that this is, for them, you know, a fair handwritten description of the layout. Do you think that's a fair handwritten description of the layout of the place?
I think it's close, yes, sir.
Okay. So here, where it says City Council and Mayor, that's where you are,
yes,
right?
Sir. Yes, sir.
Okay. How far did you see Ms. Tisdale go with the officers? Could put your finger on it or identify it if there's letters there.
I saw till she turned the corner going out the entryway from the council chambers.
Okay. So would that be where NT2 is marked?
That would be that area right there, yes, sir.
Okay. Did you make any other statements to the officers regarding Ms. Tisdale while this was occurring?
No, sir.
What was in your mind while this was occurring?
Unfortunate situation.
Elaborate a little bit.
The meeting was delayed. The outburst of your client, Ms. Tisdale, in the meeting disruptive, and it's unfortunate that trying to conduct a meeting in that manner.
Okay. Trying to remember your previous testimony. Did you indicate that you had previously seen Ms. Tisdale recording the Fulton County Commission meeting?
Pardon?
Did you indicate that you had, prior to this incident, seen Ms. Tisdale video recording a Fulton County Commission meeting? Or Forsyth County Commission meeting.
I've never been to a Fulton County Commission meeting, but yes, I did. I did see her at Forsyth County.
Did you believe her to be disruptive in her recording of that meeting?
I saw her moving around in the meeting a lot, and in my meetings it would have been disruptive at the time.
So, in your mind, it's the moving with the camera that becomes disruptive,
and could be a safety issue.
Do people who attend the meetings get up and leave during the course of the meeting?
When we have an item that is finished on the agenda that's approved, people that are involved with that particular item, after the issue is resolved at that meeting and going on to the next item on the agenda, they do get up and leave. Yes, sir.
And sometimes that can be a large group if somebody's really, a group of people are really riled up about an issue. Sometimes you may have 10, 15 people getting up and leaving during the middle of the meeting, right?
I don't know about getting riled up, and a lot of people are getting up at one time and leaving, but usually it's between, if you have item one and you have a lot of people for that item on the agenda, there's between the next item, that would be when it would occur, and certainly that's not the disruptive that you may be leading to.
Okay. Do you ever see people move their seats during the course of the meeting? Go from one seat to another because their friend just arrived or some other reason?
Have I ever seen it?
Mm-hmm.
Yes, sir.
Okay. Have you ever seen people get up and move to a different place because they had to go out and go to the bathroom or
yes,
had to leave the meeting to make a phone call?
Yes, sir.
Have you ever seen people forget to turn the phone off? I know.
Yep.
I've done it.
Yes, sir.
Absolutely. Have you confiscated their phone?
No, sir.
Is that disruptive to the meeting?
It is.
Were people unable to move past Ms. Tisdale in the location she had her camera?
Object to form.
I believe she testified that she had her camera at NT1?
At the
beginning. Okay. Ms. Tisdale testified that she had her camera located at NT1 at the time you called for its removal. Do you agree or disagree with that statement?
I disagree because originally her, and she also testified that I threw her out of the meeting, which is certainly not true. Originally the camera was sitting right here when I came into the meeting.
Okay. And for the record, he's referencing the side aisle to the right side if you're sitting at
right.
Council table.
Okay.
Or
this is where
right
it originally was, and immediately.
Just a minute. I just want where he's pointing to be clear on the record.
Okay.
So if you don't mind, however you want to handle that, but the record's not going to reflect
yeah,
him.
Yeah, no. I'm just thinking of what letters we should use. Let's do G for Gravett, then NT1. So if you could write G for Gravett, NT1,
Where she was at first.
Yeah.
Prior to the meeting.
Yes, and we're going to get into that. Okay, and we need to mark it NT1. Oh, or G1 is fine. Let's just do it as G1. Unless you...
That's fine. Okay. G1's fine.
And Ms. Tisdale was located at G1 prior to the beginning of the meeting, right?
Prior to the meeting beginning, and okay. when I walked in, she was moving her camera to this area in here.
Okay.
Not behind the seats where that shows, but it was in this area.
Okay, and you're pointing to where T2 is.
That says T2 if you...
Yeah. Is that where you're pointing?
It was in that vicinity, okay. Yes, sir.
So her movement of the camera was prior to the meeting's beginning, correct?
It was prior to me calling meeting to order, yes, sir.
Okay. And at the time you order the removal of the camera, it's fixed at location T2 where you just described it, correct?
Yes, sir.
Okay. So she's only made one movement of the camera from G1 to T2, correct?
That I saw.
Okay. And that was prior to the meeting's beginning, correct?
Yes, sir.
Okay. And now my question is, where Ms. Tisdale had her camera located at T2, were persons in the aisles able to move past her?
Objectify.
And let me rephrase the question. At the time Ms. Tisdale had her camera located at T2, was it your understanding that persons had room to move past her?
I didn't see any moving past her, so I can only assume what might have been going to happen.
And what I'm asking is your understanding. Where she was located at T2 with her camera and her tripod, was it your understanding that there was room for ingress and egress down the center aisle if someone needed to leave that area?
I can only assume. Is that what you want me to do?
I'm asking what your understanding
is. I can assume it would have been a safety issue that could have tripped on the tripod.
Okay. What, under your testimony, how many feet were there clear between the last leg of the tripod going out into the aisle? And is this an actual barrier of some sort?
It's a center aisle.
Okay. The center aisle is marked as center aisle, and then there are lines going perpendicular to the line from here. I'm trying to describe this, and tell me if I'm not. Are these lines any objects?
No.
Okay, so that's clear.
Yes, sir.
So if somebody's walking into an aisle, they don't have to hop over it. Or walking from the aisle into a seat, they don't have to hop over anything, correct?
Not unless someone was in the aisle.
Okay. So now my question would be, I think we've clarified that these two lines are not, in fact, any kind of barrier, correct?
That's correct. It's like church pews.
Yeah.
That's a good way for people to think of it.
That's a great way to think of it. Okay. For someone to walk down the center aisle, not run into the church pews, and get past Tisdale, Ms. Tisdale, at T2, how many feet are we talking about?
Objective form.
I tried my best.
How many feet are you talking about the aisle's width?
The space that was available between the closest leg of Ms. Tisdale's tripod and the benches that were, you know, the church pews.
Well, and again, I'm speculating. I'm assuming.
You're using the best of your knowledge. Sure.
The tripod probably takes up 2 foot from one leg to the other,
mm-hmm.
maybe. And I'd say you may have 2 foot space. So maybe you got 4 foot between them altogether.
Okay. So your testimony is that the space between the church pews on where NT5 is marked, let's use that, and the associated church pew on the upper end of the center aisle is approximately 4 feet.
I would assume.
Okay.
I haven't taken a ruler out and measured, and I'm not sure that the tripod is 2 foot, but If you have a ruler, we can verify it, but I'm not sure of that.
Okay, no, that's I'm just trying to get a sense of it. And where Ms. Tisdale has her tripod located at T2 in her camera, let's say there's a fire, she's at the very back, so she would just simply need to grab her tripod and move it slightly, right, to get it out of the aisle?
Object to form.
If we had a fire?
Yeah, if there was some reason, some safety reason, to have to move the tripod, if it's in the middle of the center aisle, that's going to create some problems, right? Because she has to move it all the way back and then get it out of the way. It seems like she's got it located at the very back, so if she has to move it, she just moves it to the corner.
I think it was in the vicinity of maybe the second row to the back, somewhere right in that area.
Okay, and that's where the teaching is marked. Okay.
And if it's sitting in the tripod's sitting in the center of the aisle, and the aisle is 4 foot wide, and you have a foot on each side of the tripod for anybody to pass by an emergency.
Mm-hmm.
Situation,
mm-hmm.
I can see where that would be compromising safety during
okay.
the meeting.
Okay. Are there ever occasions where you need to reserve pews for particular persons?
I've never had that request.
Like, say you've got a Boy Scouts group who's going to get an award and you want to put them all on the same aisle.
I've never had that request.
Okay. Have you ever had to move people from one seat to the other because of something related to the meeting that you needed to get some certain people in one section?
I've never had that request, and certainly the building's handicapped, so they can, you know, move a wheelchair up and down.
Okay. Then there's no reserve seating in the meeting?
No, never have. They had that request.
Okay. Let's continue. I don't know that we've got anything more on it, but let's see.
You were violating Georgia state law, in which.
Was that you?
This is illegal. You cannot close the meeting. I have a right by Georgia law, and you should consult your counsel.
Was that your voice back there? You're certainly able to something.
I didn't hear my voice.
Okay, let's play it back. Just.
With Georgia Attorney General not allowing me to film this meeting. Okay. Take your hands off of me. Take your hands off of me, sir. Let me get my phone back. I'm sorry.
How are you, ma'am?
You were violating Georgia state law. Open and which? Oh, okay. Fair enough.
And that does sound like
this
you.
This is illegal.
I can't.
You cannot close.
I can't make it out.
Okay. Do you recall making any statements about your? I'm just trying to refresh your memory. It sounds like you're certainly able to, and then it's a little bit muddy after that. But it sounds like something about record. Do you recall making any statements along those lines?
And looking at the cities, I think I made a statement relative to when we don't live recording, we don't have Comcast here. That might have been what it was.
Okay. Okay.
Or we don't have Comcast.
Have you ever had any discussions with anybody about Deputy Hester's termination?
No, sir.
Do you know Patricia Hamby?
I do.
Tell me how you know her.
She runs Foster House Restaurant.
Have you had any discussions with her about this incident?
I haven't.
Have not?
I have not.
Who's Jeff Davis?
It's her son-in-law.
Oh, Miss Hamby's son-in-law?
Yes, ma'am. Okay. Yes, sir. I think that's right.
Have you had any discussions with Mr. Davis about this incident?
I have not.
me show you just what's been previously marked as plaintiff's exhibit one. What is this?
That's a policy. You asked me a question?
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
That's a policy that that we use and have been using after April 17th meeting for the open meetings law.
Okay. Have you ever had a written policy like this before regarding what can and can't be done by citizens at a public meeting?
No, sir.
And without getting into what you said with your attorneys, did you develop this policy in consultation with them?
The attorney brought this and said this is what the law would require the city.
Don't.
Just yes or no? How about that?
Yes.
Okay.
Thank you.
And tell me, why is it under Gerald Blackburn's name?
Gerald's our city manager, and he would be the one to, if anybody requested the records, he'd be one to provide this.
Okay, so it's in case somebody requested it under the public meeting or public records law, right?
That could be one thing.
Okay. Why else might somebody request this?
Why would they suggest it to see if the city had any information about the open meetings law?
Okay, so there's no particular significance to Gerald Blackburn having his name at the bottom of this?
It could have been my name.
Okay. And this is a policy that you can change if you want to at some point, right? I mean, it's changeable. It's not, you can vote, you can decide to change it at some later point, right?
Since we've been admonished by the AG and know what the law is, I think it's a state law. I, even though it's our policy, I don't know that we could deviate from that.
Okay.
To me now, that's the law.
You can develop new policies if you like, correct? As long as they're consistent with state law, you can develop any new policies you want, right?
Do you mean generally?
Generally.
Or?
Okay. Yeah.
And I'll just object to the extent it calls for a legal conclusion, but you can answer based on your understanding.
Mostly that's what the city charter is made up of ordinances that's been developed by the city of Cumming.
Okay. Is this the only written, this is not an ordinance, this is a policy. Is this the only written policy that you have?
I think I testified that's true.
Okay. The only one in general that you have. You don't have a written policy or anything else.
Well, the city charter goes back a long way, and I don't remember anything referenced that there have been done.
Okay. Okay. Is it your understanding that anyone who runs for election to city council or the mayor has to pay a qualifying fee?
Is it my understanding? Yes, it's a qualifying fee.
Okay.
That's my understanding. I think that's what our charter specifies.
Okay, and you have to pay a qualifying fee whether you're opposed for a re-election or not, correct?
Unless you qualify as a pauper.
Okay. And in your campaign contribution disclosure statement, you're required to identify all cash that is part of the fund for your campaign, correct?
I object to the extent it calls for a legal conclusion, but you can testify as to your understanding.
Question.
Your campaign contribution disclosure report is required in your understanding to contain all funds that you've received and expended for a campaign, correct?
I think you're correct. Yes, sir.
And that would include a qualifying fee, that is expended, correct?
Yes, sir.
Okay. And in your financial disclosure report, you're required to list all properties that you own, correct?
Yes.
Okay. And you cannot exclude certain properties, correct?
Object to the extent it calls for a legal conclusion, but you can
sure.
testify subject to your understanding.
It's my understanding.
Okay. And this is, I think, the last question in this area, but to the best of your knowledge, have you included all campaign contributions in your campaign contribution disclosure report?
All of my campaign contributions?
Mm-hmm.
That's the question.
Yeah.
Yes.
Okay. And to the best of your knowledge, and these are all three related, but have you articulated in your campaign contribution disclosure report all expenditures you've made during the course of each campaign?
Some of his campaigns probably predated the campaign disclosure laws. He's been mayor for 30-something years.
Okay.
I know the law has changed over
sure.
that period of time.
Let's do last 10 years, because I think, yeah.
That's fair. Okay.
I haven't collected any money, so what money has been spent was personal money.
Okay. And last question along these lines is, in your... I got the document correct. In the financial disclosure statement that you make in connection with the campaign, you've identified over the last 10 years each property that you own, correct?
It's been amended, I think, but yes, I try to keep up with it.
Okay. Tell you what might be most efficient is, why don't we take like a 5-minute break? Because I'm near the finish of the deposition, and I just want to figure out whether we've got some additional questions anyhow. So
that'll be fine. That might be quicker than sitting there reading notes.
Yep.
Ms. Tisdale.
All right, and we're back on? Just to clarify for the record, the second video that we've displayed and been talking about is Plaintiff's Exhibit 4 in the continuing set of exhibits that will be provided to the court reporter along with Plaintiff's Exhibit 7, which is the Fox 5 interview. So I don't think we identified it when we went into it. Just a few more questions for you. First, if you could give us the names of your deceased brothers and sisters as well, just for...
And this would be redacted? Or do you
yeah, care? I'm sorry. Yes, redacted.
Thank you.
Okay. I think that's not... Yep, that works. When I asked you about the business interests and property interests... those were all I was able to obtain from public records. I just wanted to make sure that I hadn't left anything off in terms of businesses that you have a financial interest in or properties you have a financial interest in.
Are you excluding his home place because you haven't asked him about his home place because I don't think it's owned by a corporation?
Okay. With that exception.
I mean, you can ask about that. I just
wanted to. And we only needed that for the names, by the way.
Right.
Any financial interest I have is I own the company.
Okay. And on your financial disclosure statements for the state of Georgia for elections, have you identified all corporate entities and business interests that you have an interest in as required by those forms, to the best of your knowledge, over the last 10 years?
updating them periodically. That might be a question, but I'd have to go back to my accountant and check with it and see. But I usually rely on my accountant to go with these.
Okay. I think we have, I mean, have we identified all companies during the course of this deposition that you have a financial interest in?
You identified a lot that I don't know anything about that I don't have a financial because I don't know who they are.
Okay.
And are you excluding things like if he owns a mutual fund that owns 50 different companies or something like
that?
Yes.
Okay. Yeah.
So subject to that exclusion.
And I think we're done?
Yeah, I didn't have anything else.
Okay. I think we're done.
Okay. Thank you very much.